grade 30, 43, 70, grade 80, 100, 120.
Huh?
What's the difference? Which are for lifting? Does my application require 80 or 120? Today, we're answering all your questions about chain grade. My name is Ben, and this is the Lifting and Rigging Channel. And today, I'm joined by Carlo. Some call him the Chain Whisperer. I like to call him the Chainiac. To the uninitiated, you know, chain is chain, right? But to you, you have a bit more of an eye for chain. How did you get the nickname Chain Whisperer, Carlo?
That's an interesting story. I was visiting a customer in Seattle. I just rushed the chain drum. I picked up the chain and I was looking at it and saying, hey, did you know, guys, that this chain was made at our factory in France? And that's how the nickname Chain Whisperer came to be. But I like the Chainiac.
We're going to dive deep into chain grade and really explain the different applications for chain grade, and so help people determine which chain is better for their use. Can you start by just walking us through what is chain grade?
It's a classification in order to determine how strong the chain is. The higher the grade, the stronger the chain. There are two important factors to be considered. Not only the strength of the chain, which is measured and determined and classified the grade, but also its hardness. So two concepts are key by the chain, the strength and the hardness. It's a simple scientific formula. You basically pull the chain to the ultimate tensile strength until it breaks, and you have a value that you can measure in joule, newton, kilonewton. Focus on the decanewton, and then if you look at the chain and you slice the chain link in half, you look at two rods looking at you, so use geometry to determine how big is the surface, and you divide the force by the surface, and a grade is decanewton per square millimeter. So grade 80 is 80 decanewton per square millimeter. 100 is 100 decanewton per square millimeter. And 120, you guess it. 120 decanewton per square millimeter. So the very basic, I would say, is a grade 30. So around 30 decanewton per square millimeter would be needed to break it. Somebody call it the proof coil, or BBB chain, also in military grade is usually. Then you have HT chain, grade 43. It's the first chain that has been calibrated, meaning pulled to the manufacturing proof load during the manufacturing phase. And then you have a grade 50 and grade 60. If you move to a different material, which is stainless steel, then you go back to carbon or alloy steel, and you have a grade 60 or grade 70 used for different purposes like transport. And then you have the Champions League of the chain, which is grade 80, grade 100, and grade 120. The first clue is you look at the finishing, but that is not a definitive clue that can tell you what the grade of the chain is.
For example, grade 70 is this is also grade 70, correct?
Exactly. The thing is, you have to pick it up, look exactly at any marking, and usually you find a marking. The bare minimum is every 7 links. You have to find a marking. And here I see one marking, and look, it's C7, right?
Mm-hmm.
So 7 is the class of the chain, and that tells you that's a grade 70 chain. That's the only reliable way to determine the class or the grade of the chain is by looking at any marking. The finishing goes a little bit beyond aesthetic. In order to give to the chain a certain protection against rusting, there are different layers of coating. The very basic is you dip the chain in oil. The oil will eventually evaporate, disappear, and then the chain will rust relatively fast. Then the very first layer of coating would be a spray paint. Then you have an epoxy painting. Then you have different layers of variation of this epoxy painting where you substitute the plastic with zinc flakes. And then it is a relatively good coating that is even used in the military. A higher level, a step up in terms of coating would be electroplating, then hot dip galvanized.
And then some are powder coated, correct?
Yeah, the powder coating is a way to protect the chain. But let's say if you have to classify it, that's stronger against rusting, powder coating is less than the zinc flake technology, and all of them are below electroplating and hot dip galvanized. That's the number one. 330 is usually hot dip galvanized, as you can see here. It's usually used for decoration purposes of anchoring pontoons or buoys. There is no mechanical value of this chain. It's just more aesthetic, and you can use it for marine purposes because it behaves quite well in a salty environment, in a marine environment.
And can it be used for lifting?
Absolutely not. That's a no-go for lifting. HT chain, high test chain, it's a chain that is used just fencing. Sometimes you use it at the back of a truck. So it has no mechanical value. But interesting enough, usually a grade 40 chain. The grade 40 is very popular for anchoring. Grade 43, they use for tie down applications still, especially here in the States.
Can you use it for overhead lifting?
Absolutely not. Okay. Like all the other carbon chains, it's not supposed to be used for that purpose. These gold plated, so which is electroplated, the finishing is basically dipping in a electrolytical solution. The most popular chain for lashing application here in the States. That's a grade 70.
And why is that? Why is it the most popular lashing chain?
Because it offers relatively high strength, the grade 70 strength compared to the grade 43. And by doing that, you can lash equipment with less material than if you were using a grade 43. So
what's the difference between this grade 70 and this grade 70?
Well, as you can see, the aesthetic. One is electrolytical coating, and this is dip into a liquid zinc. So this is hot dip galvanized, and that is a slightly better coating against rusting. And this chain in particular is used for anchoring.
Can you use grade 70 for overhead lifting?
Not at all. Only alloy chain can be used for lifting. We are talking here about the Champions League of the chain, a different raw material. When the grade 80 was born by changing the recipe of the alloy and allowing a higher mechanical performance of 80 decanewton per square millimeters.
So can you use grade 80 for overhead lifting?
You should be using grade 80 for overhead lifting. The best application for the grade 80, if you want to have a higher buffer zone against exposure to high temperature, the grade 80. So my tip is use the grade 80 when you're aware you're exposing chain to relatively high temperatures.
Grade 100. And people might notice this grade 100 chain, it's not blue. So a lot of people say grade 100 is always blue, right?
If I see a chain around which is painted blue, I tend to believe it may be a grade 100, but always you have to look at the marking.
Right, so that's color, finish, this means nothing to chain.
No, you have to look at the marking, that definitely. Basically, the grade 100 was an upgrade of the grade 80 during the 90s. By tweaking a little bit the way you do the heat treatment, you could achieve a higher grade using the same material and keeping the elongation, which is mandatory. You have to have an elongation with 20%, which is typical of all alloy chain. You have to stretch at least 20% before breaking. Eventually, there was also a switch in the type of alloy that was used and is used for the grade 100 today. Where it is used, in any application where you want to have more safety, this chain is performing 20% more than grade 80. So every time you need to lift something heavier, or you want to possibly reduce the size of the chain, the grade 100.
So are there any specific applications that you should be choosing 100 over 80 or 80 over 100?
Not necessarily. I would say they are complementary on the market. The grade 80 has a stronger performance in marine environments. So if you have some rigging to be performed on an oil rig, they prefer using the grade 80. thank you for allowing me to talk about my favorite chain, which is the Gray 120. The Gray 120 was introduced by Pewag back in 2003. So it's 22 years ago that we are out on the market with the Gray 120. A chain that is the outperformer, 50% more than Grade 80. So by doing that, you can reduce the size. Imagine you have 1/2 inch chain in Grade 80, you could go down one size at 3/8 in Grade 120. So that's brilliant. Less material doing the same job. Where can you use it? I would say in a factory setup, that's the way to go, where you're handling very heavy piece of equipment and you wanna be handling it with lighter material than Grade 80 or Grade 100.
So I also noticed that Grade 120, there's a different shape to this link. Is that all Grade 120 or is this specific to Pewag 120?
Okay, Pewag has two types of Grade 120. One is the regular round profile. This chain in particular was engineered specifically with this profile so that the point of contact between two chain link is not the one single point of contact that you have here, where all the load and wear and tear of the chain while doing its job is focusing on one single contact point between two chain link. Our Grade 120 was designed and engineered so that the point of contact resides on one side and on the other. So you have 4 points of contact. This chain is 4 times more durable than a regular Grade 80 or Grade 100. I have to ask myself, what do I need the chain for? So if I need the chain just to do some fencing in my backyard, the mechanical performance of the chain doesn't really matter. But then if you're buying a chain for anchoring purposes, I wouldn't buy a chain online. You want to go to a specialized shop that is selling you real anchor chain made in Grade 40 or Grade 70, hot dip galvanized. A rigging shop like Mazzella, so the expert in the field. That's the go-to address. Any grade for rigging, you go to a rigging shop.
Would it make sense to buy a Grade 100 chain for a tie-down application that you could use a Grade 70?
Yes. All the alloy chain being used in tie-down application, it's actually advisable. If you ask me, I would always recommend the Grade 120 over Grade 70 for tie-down application because you have one unique feature here, is the shape. Not only you have a higher mechanical performance, but also the shape when it's going through corner. If you're laying on the corner, you see you have one side of the chain which is leaning on the edge, and that gives you way more protection than if you were to use a round profile chain that has one point of contact on that corner. The environment plays indeed a role. If you think about using rigging equipment on a construction job site next to the seawater, for instance, and you know that your rigging equipment will be exposed to salty environment constantly, you rather think preemptively and buy a rigging equipment that has a coating like a PCP coating that will protect against rust. Or if you have an environment like you are exposed to an aggressive acid environment, like you are in a water treatment plant. In a water treatment plant, I would rather use a totally different material, stainless steel, Grade 50, Grade 63, because that chain has a way better performance against these acid attacks from the outside. Grade 80 being ideally suited to be exposed to relatively high temperature. So if you have a forging plant or in anywhere where you're exposing your rigging equipment to very high temperature, you want to know who made that chain. Who's the producer? Is that a reputable producer using locally sourced raw materials, steels? Is this producer belonging to a system when they have a reliable supply of power? The worst accident that could happen during the manufacturing of a chain is you're running out of power or the power grid is unstable and you're producing millions of wells in those chain links. Imagine if the current and electricity that you use doing the welding, something was off. So you have one chain link ready to be a big problem. If your producer makes those chains in a country where there is unstable power supply, that could be also a concern.
Is there anything else that people should know about chain grade or chains in general before they make a purchase?
It's not just the chain that you're buying also components. So it is very important to understand how the component fits together with the chain. In this case, you have a component that is rated to be working with the chain. I personally have seen out in the field combination of those grade 100 master link with our grade 120 chain. Is it acceptable? Of course not. Because in the combination between the chain and the components, you want the chain to fail first, because that's the purpose of having a chain that elongates. There you have the warning sign. You need the grade of the component only in conjunction with the chain. The grade of a program is called by the chain, not by the components. Components are accessory to the chain.
But what can go wrong if you choose the wrong chain grade?
A lot can go wrong. So the chain snaps, open up, and with no warning, you may lose your load, damage your load, injure somebody, or worst case scenario, somebody get killed.
There's a lot that goes into chain, a lot more than most people think goes into chain. So, you know, just make sure you're an informed buyer before you get out there and just make a purchase.
Indeed.
Hopefully this video answered all the questions that you might have about chain grade. If not, drop your questions in the comments and Carlo or I will get you an answer. Mazzella is here to help with all your chain needs, be that custom sling assemblies, transport, or any other application you might have. Feel free to give us a call or contact us through the links below. If you found this video useful, informative, entertaining, or you just feel like being friendly, then hit that like button so we can get this information out to everyone who needs it. If you have a question, drop it in the comments. My name is Ben. Stay safe out there.